We have been for some time looking at the gifts of the Spirit. Amen. The gifts of the Spirit. Last week we looked at the discernment of spirits. Amen. And we looked at it from the various dimensions. Hallelujah. One of the spectacular things that God has revealed to us in this study of the gifts of the Spirit has been that striking revelation that these other gifts are the eyes of faith. Amen. Praise the Lord. Faith is not blindness. Amen. Faith is not blindness. To the world, it looks foolish. To the world, it is stupid. Amen. Praise the Lord. It is stupid, it is foolish, but to them that are being saved, it is the power of God unto salvation. Praise the Lord. Is it the spiritual things of God? Is it the natural man cannot receive them because they are what? Spiritually discerned. Praise the Lord. So if it is going to be received, it has to be spiritually discerned. Amen. And so these gifts, we also found out that they are the rewards of what? Righteousness. Amen. The rewards of faith. Righteousness is the reward of faith. Amen. When you believe in God, God rewards you with righteousness. Hallelujah. The Bible says that Abraham believed God and it was credited to him as righteousness. When you believe in God, that is what you receive. You receive righteousness. Amen. Praise the Lord. To anybody who is a believer, he said, what's your reward in Christ? Amen. Hallelujah. Your reward in Christ is righteousness. Only you shall be. Amen. Your reward in Christ is not house, neither is it car, or money, or wife, or children, or any of those things. Your reward is what? Righteousness. I wonder what reward the robber that was crucified with Christ was looking for on the cross. He said, Lord, today remember me in what? In paradise. Hallelujah. That's all. He didn't say, remember me, I've not married, I don't have kids. Remember me, I don't have money. Remember me, I don't have house, I don't have this, I don't have that. He said, remember me in your paradise today. Praise the Lord. That's what matters. At the end of the day, that's what matters. And he said, today, you will be with me in paradise. Amen. Hallelujah. That's why I keep telling us, what we do here is reverse engineering. Amen. Reverse engineering. We start from the end and we move backwards. Amen. Because that gives you balance in life. Praise the Lord. Jesus said, what shall it profit a man to gain the whole world and to lose his soul? So you are looking at the end. And then when you look at the end, you walk backwards. Amen. You look at the end. And then you walk backwards to now. And then you tell yourself the truth. What should I be looking for now? Because the end is the now. It's not at that time that you will be looking for it. It is now. That you say, now is the hour of salvation. Yes, now is the accepted time. Now is the hour of salvation. So it is now that you begin to walk towards the end. Hallelujah. So whilst, you know, the outward man perisheth. He said the inward man is renewed day by day. That is to say, the inward man continues to make progressive movement towards the realization of that eternal glory. Amen. Praise the Lord. So now is the time to do that. Some people get crazy when you tell them that all that they are doing is vanity. That is true. It's vanity. Amen. Whether you want to hear it or you don't want to hear, you don't want to believe it or not. They say, see you at the top. Where is that top?
Vanity upon vanity.
Hallelujah. You have ambition, you have goal. What is that ambition? Vanity upon vanity. What is that goal you are looking for? Praise the Lord. What are you looking for? The man who became the world's richest man, and he's still the world's richest man. What does he do with his money now? He's using his money to take care of those in third world countries. Amen? Fighting diseases and all manner of things that he's doing. So people don't even believe that, you know, whatever he's doing is real. For me, it doesn't really matter to me whether it's real or not. Praise the Lord. But we are seeing the futility of it all right before our eyes. That's the world's richest man. Right before our eyes. What is he doing with the wealth? Praise the Lord. When you even look at other people that are within the same, you know, the same place where he is, they are doing the same similar things. Warren Buffett said to Bill Gates, since this is what you and your wife wants to dedicate your life doing, I'm going to give you all my wealth. Hallelujah. That's the second world's richest man. So I'm going to give you all that I have. Just use it and be taking care of humanity. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. It's only in this, you know, that's why I keep telling us that you are only poor in your mind. That's where you are poor. Praise the Lord. A man is poor in his mind. So you find out that in all his actions, though he may be physically rich, and that of a desperate man, desperate woman, who is still haunted by the mindset of poverty. Praise the Lord. Yes. Because Jesus said to the church, he said, you are rich and you feel you don't have need for anything. He said, but you don't know that you are poor, you are miserable, you are wretched, you are blind, and you are naked. Praise the Lord. So you can see, though they had physical riches, Jesus said they were what? Poor. Amen. And the reason why they were poor was because their minds were still, you know, filled with what? Poverty. Amen. They were physically rich, but they were still poor in their mind. Amen. And that's what you have prevalent in our world, so to say. We are poor in the mind because we have been very unfortunate, you know, having wicked leaders all the way left and right. And so in our world, we believe that these things are something. Whilst those people in developed countries don't see it as anything because they live in it every day. Amen. And it doesn't mean anything to them. Praise the Lord. But for us, because we have been impoverished in our minds and physically too by our leaders, we cannot see beyond our nose. So we have value for things. We're ready to kill for things. We're ready to maim for things. We do things that are abominable just for things. Hallelujah. That is poverty of the mind. The mind is so poor that all that he can think of is his or her stomach. Praise the Lord. He said, whilst the outward man perisheth, the inward man is renewed day by day. It is the end that matters. Finding rest with God. Hallelujah. And so that should guide everything that we do. Hallelujah. It should guide everything that we do. And that's why we talk about the gifts of the Spirit, the eyes of faith. Hallelujah. The eyes of faith help us to realize that, you know, the business we have here to do is the business of God. Amen. Praise the Lord. Jesus said, I must walk whilst it's day. It is day. He said, the night cometh when no man shall be able to walk. Praise the Lord. In other words, with these gifts of the Spirit, we are able to stay in tune with the business of God. Hallelujah. Amen. We stay in tune with the business of God. Because with that, with the gifts of the Spirit, you have the word of wisdom. You have the word of knowledge. You have faith. You have the healing. You have working of miracles. You have prophecy. You have speaking in tongues.
You have interpretation of tongues. You have discernment of spirit.
And then there are so many other gifts that are also given by the Spirit. Amen. There is also the ministerial gifts, that of the apostle, that of the pastor, the teacher, the prophet, the evangelist. Hallelujah. So many other offices that operate in the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. And all these gifts are given to the children of God for the service of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. And so the reason why we have taken time to look into these gifts is simply because it is critical to what we are doing. The Bible talked of the children of Issachar. It said they were the ones that knew what Israel ought to do and at what time. Praise the Lord. They knew what Israel had to do and at what time. Praise the Lord. What a miserable life. Jesus said that you are poor, you are wretched, you are miserable, you are naked and you are blind. What a miserable life. But when the world looks at you, they say, God win. You are blessed. Amen. You are lifted. God has taken you higher. God win. Amen. That's when the world looks at you, that's what they see. They see God win. Amen. That's what they see. God win. And you will be singing it though. And that's God win. But what is Jesus Christ seeing? He's seeing wretchedness, blindness, poverty, misery. That's all that he sees. But what the world sees is God win. Do you blame the young man? He has collected his money and his fame that goes along with a popular song. You are not complaining. That's what the world wants now. That's what the world wants. So even unbelievers and believers alike love the song. That's what you go to church, that's what they sing. You come to unbeliever world, that's what that one sokanarize, from myself. Caledian the church. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. But what is Jesus saying? That is what matters. And the only way you can know what Christ is saying is through this manifestation of the gifts of the Spirit. Hallelujah. Both in the US and in Nigeria, television crews have gone to these so-called miracle workers, these so-called men of God who do miracles. And they have gone to them severally and said to them, you come on TV and you show all manner of miracles. We're not interested in so many of them. We just want to document one. We're not interested in all the things you have been showing, We just want to document one miracle. One. They couldn't show them one. Not one. They went to them officially. They couldn't show them one. They now disguise themselves. Igbo man. They now disguise themselves and came as worshippers too, with hidden cameras. To witness the miracle now, they didn't see one. Not one authentic miracle. In fact, there were some three people or thereabout that claimed that they were healed. Journalists. They came and gave testimony. They followed them to their house. Yes. So you gave testimony that you are here. Hi, how are you now? The whole thing is, I don't know what happened, but I'm still where I am. But you came out and told us, that God, in fact, they made it, sometimes you say, oh, these people are unbelievers, they are devils. Obasanjo, somebody called me when Obasanjo was about to ban showing of miracles on TV. He said, man of God, you need to pray. Hi, that is evil. I say, it's not evil. That is God using him. What did Obasanjo say? If you, it is true that God uses you to heal people, left, right, and center. Go to the hospitals. There are so many sick people there. God, we need you there. Go and be praying for them so that God will be healing them. Praise the Lord. You know, people do a lot of stuff here and get away with it. You know, in those Western countries, that's why most times, you know, many times, even if it's only in Africa and third world countries, that's where you have those things rampant. Because even if they do it over there, they do it with style because they know the law will come against them. You know, about three people or so died from imago, those kind of prophecies and stuff like that. They sued them and they had to go and settle them. Those people in millions or outside of court. That the family was now suing the men of God. He told us he's healed and he left his drug and he died in the process. He paid compensation. But our people love falsehood. What I see is that the church in particular loves falsehood. The church loves falsehood. Koboko night. Break through, break this, break that. Yeah? Break everything. And yet, yeah? Nothing is breaking anywhere. And then when they conduct such programs, people will kill themselves, you know, going to those places. Especially women. They are mostly the targets. When they tell them that, let them come for special prayers for marriage. They Hallelujah. For people love falsehood. That's why it is strange that we are involved in this kind of ministry, because this is Oluwakuwo war in short, because nobody wants to hear this. Amen. Nobody is interested in this. No. They love falsehood and they're ready to pay you handsomely, you know, as long as you continue dishing the falsehood to them. Praise the Lord. But whether you love falsehood or not, the truth of the matter is that there will always be a day of reckoning. Amen. There will always be what? A day of reckoning. So feel free and love whatever you love. There will always be a day of what? Reckoning. That day, you will know whether you have made the right choice or the wrong choice. But I pray that you will make the right choice. Amen. That is why these gifts of the Spirit have been given. But people love falsehood. Now, the fact that you have so many fakes out there does not mean that these gifts are not real. Hallelujah. Amen. It does not mean that the gifts are not real. Today we will talk on the gift of healing. Amen. It doesn't mean that it is not. Jesus said, "And this sign shall follow them that believe." He said, "In my name, they shall do what? They shall lay hands upon the sick, and they shall do what?" Yeah. "In my name, they shall lay hands upon." And even when he was around, the Bible says he gave power to the disciples. He said, "Go heal the sick, raise the dead, cast out devils, cause the lame to walk, the deaf to hear, and the blind to see." Praise the Lord. So those things were... It was a regular thing with the church. Praise the Lord. Healing was a regular thing with the church. That is, not was. Praise the Lord. That is, not was, the signs of them that what? Believe. He said, "These signs shall do what? Follow them that believe. That in my name they shall lay hands upon the sick. And they shall recover." So it is not a myth. Praise the Lord. It is not a myth. And he said, "This sign shall follow them that believe." He didn't say this sign shall follow the pastors or the bishops or the apostles. Hallelujah. He said, "This sign shall follow them that do what? That believe. That in my name they shall do what? Lay hands upon the sick and they shall recover." Amen. Praise the Lord. The reason why it looks like in our days that this is not happening is simply because the church is busy believing God for the wrong things. Is somebody hearing me? Praise the Lord.
If you look at the early church, it was a normal thing with the early church. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. These kind of things were normal with the early church. And it was so because they had little or no distraction. Remember in those days, they had things in common. Praise the Lord. Amen. So these gifts, as it were, was rampant in that time. Praise the Lord. But because today, people don't go to church to seek Christ anymore. Today, people go to Christ to seek the world. Amen. They don't go to church to seek Christ. They go to church to seek the world. And so, little wonder these things are like magic to us. We don't even believe them anymore. Praise the Lord. We don't leave it out anymore. Praise the Lord. I am not in the class of those who believe that Christians should not go to hospital. That is an aberration of the gospel. Amen. I'm not in that class. I do believe that medical science is yet part of God's grace for man. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Praise the Lord. But even though that I believe so much in the fact that medical science is part of God's grace or God's mercy, amen, shown unto man, I am also a strong believer in the power of God to heal. Amen. Hallelujah. I am a strong believer in the power of God to heal. Praise the Lord. And so that is why I keep telling you that faith has eyes. Amen. Faith has eyes. Praise the Lord. Faith has eyes. And it can see. Amen. Are you following what I'm saying? In my own personal life, I've had situations and circumstances where I suddenly felt sick. And I prayed. And I got healed. Amen. And at other times, I've had to take medicine. Praise the Lord, to be healed. And at other times, I've had to go physically to see the doctor. Amen. For them to administer medication to me. Same can also be said of my children. Praise the Lord. There are times they will come to me with complaints, and the only thing I know I will do is to pray for them. And they get healed. And sometimes they come, and they'll be surprised. I won't even talk about prayer. I will just go, I have a pharmacy in my bedroom. So that, I have a pharmacy. So I'll just open my pharmacy cabinet and take medication and give them. Praise the Lord. They have seen with their own eyes, and they have also experienced it, that the Father God can heal. Amen. So it's not story to them. But how do you know, that's why I say faith has eyes. Because what is the Holy Spirit telling you? You don't pray blind. He said, and this sign shall follow them that believe. That is the problem with Christians today. He said, this sign shall follow them that believe. They shall lay hands upon the sea. And therefore, any sick person, you say, in the name of Jesus, come on. And the demon will almost like want to slap you back. What you are trying to do is not how the Spirit wants to deal with that particular matter. Are you following what I'm saying? It's not every sickness that has a demon behind it. Amen. It is not every sickness that has a demon behind it. But the church would want to demonize every form of sickness. Isi wagi demon. Nti bogi mbu demon. Afoton wagi demon. They see demon everywhere. Praise the Lord. So you see why it is everything. You say, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. You see, they that are led by the Spirit are the sons of God. Amen. Praise the Lord. And that's the problem. Before long, they will tell you now, in our church, we don't take medicine. In our church, we don't take medicine. But they won't tell you how many members they have lost as a consequence of that stupidity. But some fools will come there and believe that it is true. In our church, we don't take medicine. But the one who is telling you not to take medicine, when he has his own problem, he will go. Eh? I saw one abroad itself. I saw one who was always telling, I cannot be sick, this, that. But his wife ended up in hospital. And I was wondering, how did it happen? It's not, if the kind of grace that you carry, your wife should not even go to. They should know doctor should attend to her. Is it not? But that's what you tell us now. The grace is too much. So your wife should not even be in the hospital. Your grace should cover everywhere. But you took her abroad, the best hospital. Yeah? And she was being attended by the best doctors. Yeah? And then your stupid and foolish members are here. Say, we don't drink mercy. In our church, we don't. In our church, we don't take mercy. But the man carried his wife to the best hospital, yeah, outside the country. And then the people in the church are doing, in our church, we don't take mercy. Fools. Yeah? In our church, we don't take mercy. Blindness. Terrible. Sickness. Ignorance. Stupidity. And all have you. Simply because you do not have what it takes to know what the Spirit is saying. Praise the Lord. Amen. Many of the discoveries I have made whilst I've had one issue or the other have always come by the Spirit. Praise the Lord. Amen. I remember there was a time I had a particular issue and I was like, I didn't know what to do. I didn't know. And suddenly the Spirit of God reminded me. He said, that time I'd taken antibiotics, I had cold, serious, severe cold. I've never suffered cold and catarrh in my life like that before. It was severe, it was terrible, it was everything. God have mercy. At a particular time, you know when you have taken all the antibiotics, strong antibiotics, you know you can take and everything. At a particular time, I was even losing faith. Like Paul said, we were pressed above measure. Amen. In the middle of the night, I was just looking up. Didn't know what to do. And then a voice said to me, go down to the kitchen and take garlic and put it in your mouth. And I went down and I picked up garlic. And he said, just put it in your mouth. Just hold it there. Don't chew it. Just hold it. That was what I did. And immediately I did that. Suddenly, from nowhere, I started having instant relief. This was something medication could not deal with. I started having instant relief. And of course, you know human being now. That was all I did that night. Taking one garlic after the other. Whether I had the measurement, I didn't know. What I wanted was relief. But that was how I recovered from that sickness. And that led me to begin to study garlic. That was even before I now began to read up garlic to know that the thing had so much powerful nutrients in it. Your doctor can never tell you to go and take a garlic. Are you following what I'm saying? It came by the Spirit. If I should write a book on, you know, discoveries I have made like that, you'll be amazed. I'm telling you the truth. A situation whereby that was what was needed to take care of that. How do you lay hands and cast out the devil? How do you lay hands and that sickness will recover? Do you understand what I'm saying? Praise the Lord. How do you do it? Can you see sometimes why people are frustrated, especially when they have a condition, a situation, and they are wondering why God doesn't want to take care of them? Are you hearing what I'm saying? Praise the Lord. I remember as a young man, when I see people who are fat, I see them jogging on the street, I will be saying in my mind, it is good for them. It's not the food they ate. It's not the food they ate. They should jog more. They should punish themselves the more. Hallelujah. I saw what they were doing as punishment. Amen. I saw it as punishment. And foolishly, I grew up like that. But I remember sometime, you know, when I began to, you know, feel somehow in my body long, long time ago, and I would be sitting down, I would hear exercise Go and exercise.
I will say, no, that one is punishment.
It's not there. How can somebody who is not there that fat, what will you be? In fact, when I even see slim people doing this, I say, look at these two people. So I had that serious bias until I could not help myself any longer. And then one day it was like somebody was flogging me. Get up and go and do exercise. Get up and go and do exercise. That's how I found myself outside. And the first time I went out to exercise, I couldn't even reach to that gate. I started panting. And then I turned back with time. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I turned back with time, you know. And then I began to, you know, to do it gradually and gradually. But one thing that amazed me was that for the first time in my life, over a long period of time, I felt so good inside my body. And I said, is this what I have been calling punishment? I didn't know that these people were milking life. And I was looking at them and I was saying, look at them. They are punishing themselves. And they are there praying for God to heal you. When what you need to do for your body to be restored, you don't want to do it. By eating and sitting down one place and refusing to exercise, you keep damaging your body. And then you are crying and saying God doesn't want to heal you. Which prayer will heal you? Tell me. Even if the pastor lays his hand, his nose, everything on you, you will not be healed though, unless you go out and take out those toxins that are inside your system that are killing you. Unless you go and deal with the toxins. No, there's no magic the pastor can do for you. Praise the Lord. I hope you are following what I'm saying. Praise the Lord. Remember, we're talking about the gift of healing. Praise the Lord. And so God heals us in so many ways. In so many ways. And that gift, remember I told us that every gift of the Holy Ghost works in combination with others. This also works with the gift of faith. It works with word of wisdom. It works with word of knowledge. Praise the Lord. And it also works with prophecy. Yes, it works with all the gifts. Praise the Lord. In combination to bring healing and restoration. Praise the Lord. Amen. So that is God bringing healing to your body. Praise the Lord. In through that, these gifts of the Spirit. It was not a human being that was telling me to go and exercise. Praise the Lord. I've had situations where I was feeling so terrible and so confused and miserable. All I had in my ear was, go and take water and drink. Go and take water and drink. And you wonder, how will water? And immediately you go and drink water. Everything is normal. Now, how do you pray and be crying, God, heal me, when all that you need is a glass of water? Some of us are not conscious of this, but the truth of the matter is that a greater percentage of your body is made up of water. And so when there is a shortfall in supply of water in your system, your whole body becomes sick. And so how do you pray that the Spirit will put water inside your body? And some people can go a whole day without drinking water. It doesn't even come to their mind that they should drink water. Amen. And when they start having issues, they don't even know where their problem is coming from. So you see that in several and different dimensions, you see how the Holy Spirit comes in to help us. Praise the Lord. Amen. To tell us, do this, do that. Praise the Lord. I'm not a doctor, but most times when people tell me of whatever they are passing through or they're going through, I always have one thing or the other to tell. Amen? Praise the Lord. Very simple. Give out simple information. Amen. You know, and most times, you know, just it's even now that I'm discussing it that it's dawned on me that, you know, I take those things for granted, but, you know, how do I even get that wisdom? I don't even know. Praise the Lord. Amen. Because you can't even say that it's because of experience, because no one experience is the same.
Praise the Lord. But most times you find out that even in doing those things, one sees himself being guided by the Spirit. Praise the Lord. And you are able to perfectly pinpoint and say, okay, this is, you know what? This is what you need to do. And the moment you do it, I've had people say, how did you know? I say, I don't know. It's just that by his grace and by his mercy, he has given me so much enlightenment into so many things. Amen. Are you following what I'm saying? Praise the Lord. If you look at the ministry of Jesus and how that he healed sick folks, it was not all the time that he laid hands. It was not all the time that he was casting out devils. Praise the Lord. At a point, he even used mud. He used mud to put on somebody's eyes. Why didn't he lay hands and say, eyes open? He used mud and put on the person's eyes, you know, before the person could begin to see. Praise the Lord. You know, because of those things that Jesus Christ did, you find that there is a lot of abuse today. A lot of people are doing all manner. You know, I've told you, it is, these things are as the Spirit wills. You don't conjure it. Are you hearing what I'm saying? You don't conjure it. It is as the Spirit wills. But when you pray, you pay attention to the Spirit, because he will always have information to give. Praise the Lord. And so what is the need of laying hands and praying when all that the individual needs is to drink water or to go and exercise or to cut down on the stupid garbage he or she eats? So many of us eat rubbish all in the name of enjoyment, and then at the end of the day, it begins to trouble us. We are now looking for who to pray for you. You think it's magician? Hallelujah. It's not magic. Praise the Lord. So God can cause you to, you know, manifest that gift, but you have to be attentive to the Spirit to hear what he is saying. Praise the Lord. For every problem, sickness, disease, infirmity, there is a way around it. Are you hearing what I'm saying? For every problem, sickness, disease, infirmity, there is a way around it. There is a way around it. Are you hearing what I'm saying? It will always come by the Spirit. Amen. It will always come by the Spirit. Paul said, a messenger of Satan was sent to buffet me. And sometimes certain things will come around to buffet you. Amen. To teach you about the righteousness of God. Amen. Praise the Lord. And some healings take place simply by understanding the message that God wants to communicate to your spirit. That's right. It's not all the time that it is the devil, and that's the problem. Every time you're calling the devil, when the devil did not do anything, praise the Lord. Sickness can come as a natural situation. When somebody is exposed to mosquito bites, the chances are that you are going to suffer from malaria in no distant time. Praise the Lord. And some people will tell you that because of their strong faith in God, they don't suffer malaria. You have not allowed the malaria carrying mosquito to bite you. The day it bites you and transfers the distance inside your blood system, you will know that there are mosquitoes and there are mosquitoes. Praise the Lord. Some people, because of their blood type, have, not that they have immunity, but they have, you know, a stronger resistance to, you know, falling sick with malaria. But it doesn't mean that the parasite is gone or is eliminated. It doesn't, your system does not eliminate the parasite. But because you have a strong immune system, it can coexist with the immune system. But the only problem is that the day you would probably, that immune system is going to be compromised by one sickness or any other thing that will compromise it. All the malaria that should have hit you 3 years ago, they will come in one day. So it's not carelessness now that somebody is careless.
He said, come, you know, take the necessary precaution. He said, no, I'm immune to malaria. Okay, continue.
Praise the Lord. And after you will call God. Most of these things are as a consequence of carelessness. Praise the Lord. When you deal with carelessness, but like I said, that's why that gift operates with the word of wisdom, the word of knowledge, discernment, prophecy. It works with all those gifts. Amen. To pinpoint exactly where the issue is coming from. Because the Bible tells us that the word of God is health even to our bones. Amen? And to our marrows. And so you find out that every time you hear the word of God, every time the word of God comes to you, it carries life. Praise the Lord. It carries life. That life reaches into your bones, into your system, you know, bringing about healing and restoration to you. And like I said, he said, "These signs shall follow them that believe, that in my name they shall lay hands upon the sick and they shall recover." Praise the Lord. And so when the Spirit says to you, pray. Amen. Hallelujah. When he says to you, pray. Now remember I told us that righteousness is the reward of faith. Amen. When you are certain that something is the righteousness of God. Amen. It is a certainty. Praise the Lord. Amen. The reason why it is important that these gifts are in operation is simply because a lot of people have, because of, praying for somebody who is sick and nothing happened, they don't even believe that God can even heal headache. Praise the Lord. Yeah? They don't even believe that God can heal headache because they have prayed one or two times or three times and they have not seen anything happen. So they are even afraid to pray for any person. Praise the Lord. But I want to encourage you today. Amen. I want to encourage you that once you have that ministration in your spirit, amen, you have that leading, you have that conviction, go ahead and pray. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And you will see the manifestation of that gift. Amen. Praise the Lord. I can stay here and tell you, I decided to share with us things that, you know, are a little outside of really the manifestation of that gift in particular. I've tried to, you know, mention one or two things that are necessary for your health. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Praise the Lord. I can stay here and begin to give you instances upon instances of the manifestations of this gift of healing in varied dimensions. But what is more beneficial to you is what I have told you. Amen? What is important about this gift is not that you hear how okay, did this, okay. You have so many of those stories in the Bible. You have Jesus, you have the apostles. Amen. Uh-huh. The ones I try to talk to us are the ones that maybe you are not used to. Praise the Lord. Amen. Uh-huh. Bible talked about Apostle Paul. He said the grace of God was upon him so much that they took handkerchiefs from his body. Hallelujah. And that handkerchief was an instrument by which devils were cast out, many sick were healed. Praise the Lord. I said, praise the Lord. So I want you to understand so that you don't, you know, because if you know these things, you know, your life will not be, you know, it will not be as miserable as sometimes the enemy will want to present it. Because when you are sick in the body, the enemy goes to town with all manner of stories in your head. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. But I want you to know that God is still in the business of healing. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Amen. Most times, what you need is not prayer. What you need is simple lifestyle change. Amen. Simple what? Lifestyle change. And then when somebody begins to tell you about sin, amen. Praise the Lord. When somebody begins to tell you about sin being the reason why you are sick, that is story for another day. Praise the Lord. Some people believe that, especially these religious people, Once you are sick, they say it's sin. You have sinned. Amen. The only thing sin does to you is that it robs you of your confidence to pray. That's what sin does. Amen. It robs you of your confidence to pray. So sickness comes to both saints and sinners. Are you hearing what I'm saying? When a saint exposes himself to the things that will make him or her sick, he or her will do what? Become sick. It's not sin. Praise the Lord. But the only thing between the sinner and the saint is that if the saint falls sick, he or she will not have fear in his heart, unlike the sinner, who will be so fearful. Do you understand me? He will be so fearful because of sin. He lacks confidence to relate with God. But the one who is not living in sin will not be afraid because he knows that his Redeemer liveth. It's as simple as that. So it's not, you know, when you attribute it, it's because that is religious, and that is what, you know, the church people have used to hold men and women in bondage. Men and women should be free to serve God. He said, a time is coming when they that serve God, when they that worship him, will worship him in spirit and in truth. They will worship him because they love him. Are you hearing what I'm saying? They are not going to worship him out of fear, because that they heard that if you don't worship God, God will kill you. Amen. Praise the Lord. You worship God because you love God. Praise the Lord. Amen. Some people will even go to the extent that if you don't want to be sick, make sure you keep away from sin. Whether you keep away from sin or not, you are careless about your health, you will fall sick. If you are a man, a woman who loves sugar, every day you are drinking Coke, you are drinking Fanta, you are setting yourself up. This one no reach, God forbid. It's not my portion. You are setting yourself up. Prevention, they say, is better than what? Don't wait till the thing hits you, and then you now start. By that time, you have caused so much damage for your system that it will be more like a fight you will have to do all your life. Are you hearing what I'm saying? If you must take Fanta and Coke, wait until you go for function and they serve you Coke. You drink it there because you are in a social gathering. By the time you come back to your house, no matter how your throat is telling you that you need Coke, tell your throat or your body that you don't need Coke. What you need is water. If you want something that is sweet, cut orange and lick. Cut pineapple. You can do pineapple juice. You can do water. There are so many of them, watermelon juice, all manner of juice. You can do it. If you like, self, you can even do your own soda. You can do Zobo. Mix it with the pineapple, is it not? And the drink, put it in fridge. That's Coke. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So that tomorrow it will not be say, God forbid. That one, no, they work. God forbid. But when you were drinking all the rubbish you were drinking, God didn't forbid. God win that time. But now you are now suffering the thing. He said, God forbid, don't put yourself. He said, lead us not into temptation. So, if you don't know, okay, Chuam, Ewoji, before, Makitwea Natiji, in a Diriaka, and now we equal from one prophet, Ibayen another prophet. I think, no way, you know, on a real go see about Wapi. Oh, Fanta na Coke na wale pe. He na kualizi from one prophet to other. Ane fe gaju. Prophet a pio no. Ana kate ewo to fulizad. Ne no nyai ha na liale gina. But you can stop all those things now by making simple life change. You can stop all those things. Imalo those things ni nebu ihe na enwere ihe na enye gi na aru. Cut them off. Praise the Lord. Cut them off. Leave Umazi like Chimamanda Nku, na Ubelea dad. On the car weekend, her name only. Their body can be very, very active. You can deal with any anything. When as you keep getting older, your own body is going down, whether you like it or not. So you have to start taking precaution. Plenty of water will do you a whole lot of good. Exercise will do you a whole lot of good. Sometimes, you know, there are places you need to go. Somebody wants to go and get something from Isinuevunebe anymore, down Chime. Ochoa Keke Napep. You would have just walked down there, bam, back. By the time you do it, you'll be fit as a fiddle. Amen. Ochoa go to taxi my boss or gaba. Yeah. You can just wadapiam. Build your strength, build everything. Na chogo do moti gaba. These are the things in all now the problem, man. Okay, for any nana. Comfort, too much comfort, they tell you. There is no gain. When there is no pain, there is no gain. Even the world will tell you that. When there is no pain, there is no gain. But too much comfort, it's not a must that you have to sleep with the AC. Praise the Lord. If the weather is too hot and everything, try and enjoy it. It's not all the time. But every day, it's holding me here. enjoy the thing, everywhere. Fan is another culprit. He will fan. Face it away from you. Never you put fan That is the truth. They don't use it. They don't use those things.
Can we stand on our feet and appreciate God? Amen.
Jesus, Son of God, only you can save.